My name is Christina Hendricks, and I, along with Susan Nesbitt and Jacqueline Ray, who I think is not here yet, have organized this panel. Because we are interested in the scholarship of teaching and learning, and we thought many people would be as well. So the idea with this panel is to introduce what the scholarship of teaching and learning is, to talk about transitioning to working on the scholarship of teaching and learning, and to give you an example of some projects in the scholarship of teaching and learning. So we hope you will find that interesting. And then after the presenters, who will all go one after another, we'd like to save the rest of the time for discussion, so questions and answers. I also need to say that we are recording this session because there are a number of people who couldn't make it and who wanted to see it. So if there's anybody who would not like to be on camera, don't sit in the front, and so please feel free to get up and move, though we are running out of space, surprisingly. Maybe not, that's a good thing. And if there's anybody who would not like to be on camera, when you ask a question, let us know, or you can talk to me before the question period, and then I'll tell the camera person, okay, in case you want to ask a question but don't want to be on camera. This will, we hope, go up on the YouTube channel, and then we will, for UBC, and then we will post it on our Instructor Network blog and advertise it out for those who couldn't be here but wanted to. Okay, so let me introduce our speakers. The first speaker is Simon Bates, and he is Academic Director of UBC Center for Teaching, Learning, and Technology. He's also part of the leadership team of the Flexible Learning Initiative at UBC, a major five-year teaching and learning transformation program. He teaches on the Physics 101 course at UBC, which is a first-year course on energy and waves. And it's delivered to 1,700 non-majors annually. That's quite impressive. Neve Kelly, who will be going next, is a faculty member in medicine. She's a medical microbiological biologist scientist, not an MD, a scientist who is researching teaching and learning, not science, and a university science teacher who is designing curricular interventions for high school students. Through all of this, Neve is interested in cutting across barriers that exist between the humanities and sciences. And lastly, we'll have Gary Poole, who's a professor and associate director of the School of Population and Public Health in the Faculty of Medicine and senior scholar in the Center for Health Education Scholarship at UBC. He's past president of the Society for Teaching and Learning in Higher Education and of the International Society for the Scholarship of Teaching and Learning. And in 2004, he established and directed the Institute for the Scholarship of Teaching and Learning at UBC, which still exists. The Institute for Scholarship of Teaching and Learning still exists, and I think it's going to have more events happening in the future, so look for that. And with that, I will hand it over to our first speaker, Simon Bates.
Thank you. So I get to go first, and we've each been given 15 minutes, which is a notoriously difficult amount of time to speak for, because it's kind of too long if you're just trying to present one basic idea, but it's certainly not long enough for a topic like this. So this is going to be abbreviated, it's going to zip by quickly. In some ways, it's a very, very high level and simplistic overview of what is a rich and complex field. What I have got is I've got way more slides and resources than I am going to get through in the next 15 minutes, and I'm happy to make those available afterwards. So I get to start off answering probably a big question for some of you: what is software? So I thought I'd start with a definition. This is my definition: systematic inquiry into teaching and learning processes and their effectiveness made public. Of course, when you come up with a definition and you want to see if it's right, the next place you go to look is, of course, Wikipedia. Exactly. You can laugh, but I all know that you do. The Wikipedia definition is pretty good. Scholarly inquiry into student learning, which advances the practice of teaching by making research findings public. And so, just unpacking that a little bit, or deconstructing it, there's a notion there of scholarly inquiry, of deliberate, rigorous, methodological approaches. into student learning. So what we're interested in is student learning, not increasing enrollments, not necessarily cutting corners or saving dollars. And we're looking at advancing the practice for teaching. So not just looking at things that may have applicability within one very specific context, but looking across courses and in some cases across disciplines as well. And a really key aspect and one of the differentiating features of SOPL is the commitment to making and disseminating these findings, mobilizing the knowledge, putting it out there in a format that others can learn from and also build on are absolutely important. I mean, you can think no definition is ever going to be complete for everyone, and you can think of, well, where does this apply? Is it higher education or is it beyond? There's the element of grounded but not restricted by disciplinary practices. So it's not totally complete, but I think it's a very useful working definition. You'll probably come across other definitions of what SOPL is. There are many. Here's one from the Vanderbilt site. Vanderbilt have a great collection of resources, and at the end of the talk, I've tried to collect just a few of these, in no way trying to be comprehensive. And their take on it is quite like this idea of a scholarly lens, the curiosity, the inquiry, the rigor, the disciplinary variety to what happens in the classroom and how we can learn from that in terms of enhancing effectiveness. And I think the key thing is the idea of building on the work of others. So taking, extending, and contributing to the body of knowledge and the body of scholarship, such that the process that an individual SOPL researcher might go through in their own work probably starts with finding out what's been done previously in the area or in a common disciplinary setting. And then that in turn broadens out so that other people within the community can take and build from these starting points. So one thing I did want to sort of try and tease out a little bit is this is a landscape where various terms, and often very similar sounding terms, often get confused or conflated. And specifically, I wanted to articulate what I think is a key difference between scholarly teaching and the scholarship of teaching. Certainly, if you look at the senior appointments guide, for those of you with one eye on career progression and tracks, scholarly teaching is certainly a phrase that features large in there. And so my take on scholarly teaching, if you like, is being informed by and using the outputs of other research in teaching and learning, so an evidence-based approach to teaching effectiveness. But it doesn't require any sort of production or dissemination back into the community. If you like, you're consuming the wisdom of others and applying it within your own course context. But a key trait of SOPL is this idea of sharing back to the community, so making public these findings. So these slides were put together. My colleague Ido Roll, we were trying to come up with, when we were designing these, some idea of how to map the difference between scholarly teaching and SOPL. And this is what we came up with, the idea that inputs into scholarly teaching approaches both come from your own classroom and the community, and a scholarly teaching approach is to make use of that wisdom and that research back in your own classroom. But the scholarship implies contributing back into the community. So if you like, it joins up those distinct. And there's also a huge amount of variation, not just what you might learn from or use back in your classroom, but how this looks in terms of the community, from a very formal sense of journal articles, conferences and presentations, to much more informal, like discussions, conversations with peers in the hallway, or professional development events such as these. And sort of underpinning both is this idea that I keep coming back to of scholarly approaches, scholarly mindsets and practices. And if you like, the distinction between the locus of where these things are operating. So within the classroom, your aim, presumably with students, is generating learning and understanding, whereas within the community, you're building a different kind of knowledge within that group. Another thing I wanted to try and just tease out a little bit is the spectrum between teaching and the various types of research in teaching and learning. And as a sort of caveat here, this is very simplistic. It's not really, I mean, we've put it as a sequence of boxes, but it's by no means a simple linear process. I mean, the sequence is there just to make it fit nicely on the slide, rather to imply any kind of progression. But we started thinking about these different elements and the types of things they give you information or permit answers to research questions on. So we thought about, well, one goal of some of this should be improving teaching. It should be improving teaching practices. Again, the idea, this is desperately non-scientific for a scientist in physics, but it's kind of qualitative in the sense that you probably think that the engagement with improving teaching is centered somewhere around these sorts of activities. Right? So notice the sort of little slide here. There's an awful lot of teaching goes on, but it's not always done in a mode of continuous improvement or enhancement. As well as improving teaching, you might want to think across a dimension of contributing to knowledge about teaching. And I'd argue that the sort of distribution of how these various components contribute to that is slightly skewed. There are overlaps, but it's slightly skewed. And here you have the scholarship and the applied educational research and sort of foundational research on learning, sort of what we know about cognition and cognitive processing. And then finally, another way to think of it is underpinning or theories of learning, which I think is skewed towards the right-hand side. So I'm not presenting this as a kind of fixed model. I found it helpful in sort of seeing how pieces fit together that are part of the same general enterprise, but have in some cases quite distinct characteristics. And the key thing for SOCL is it lies at this intersection of all three. I think it has a real credible claim to be able to be seen as contributing to both improving teaching practice, knowledge about teaching, and theories about teaching and learning. So it's that central portion, or that region of maximum overlap. You could imagine spending an entire semester dissecting a slide with the title of How to Do SOCL. And certainly there are entire books published on it. But in a very basic sense, to me, if you boil it down to the sort of things that we might do, we ask questions, we look for answers, and then we talk or write about the outcomes of that. And I think an important thing to highlight is when talking and writing about it, it's not always just about the stunning success stories that work perfectly the first time. Because life isn't always like that, certainly in many classrooms that I've been. So in a very simplistic way, that I think are the three key elements. And in terms of the key methodologies, again, by no means a comprehensive list, but what I've done I won't step through each of these in turn, but in the slides that I can leave behind, we've sort of unpacked some more details on different methodologies. And of course, they don't have to exist in isolation. You can blend an almost infinite variety of methodologies by combining different approaches in space or in time so that you design a pretty much bespoke or unique methodology. So there's some more detail hidden in the slides that I can leave, along with some resource links to journal articles. Now, I'll hold my hand up here. They have a distinctly science bent, because that's my own area of research, and it's the literature that I know the best. I think an interesting exercise, and one that I think we'll probably try and undertake, is to build something more comprehensive around a wider spectrum of disciplinary approaches that use various methodologies. So Christina mentioned ISOTL, the Institute for the Scholarship of Teaching and Learning that Gary set up some years ago. I'm now the director of that institute, and we have a range of resources and connections that I just put up here. As Christina said, Ido recently joined CTLT from a position that he had in science, working with, well, actually jointly with science and the Faculty of Education. And with his arrival, we're really looking to build out some more activities and opportunities to connect around SOPL. So the community of practice that Bernie Garrett from the School of Nursing facilitates. We have a journal club. There's also connections through the various faculty-based initiatives. Feedback, peer-reviewed teaching initiative, and just a plea that if you are interested in connecting around this particular research questions or funding, then to get in touch with you there. The last slide is some resources, again, not particularly claiming to be comprehensive, but good jumping off points or general sort of resource banks that you might be interested in. And that was even about 15 minutes. So I'll finish there and seamlessly hand over to Neve. I can be a text.
So what I'm going to talk about is a personal story. Actually, it's a personal story of Susan's and mine. We were part of an enterprise that at CTLT that brought together a lot of different people who were interested in the scholarship of teaching and learning from a lot of different disciplines. And when we started to talk, we both identified, and then when we talked with others who were from STEM, we identified that actually, although this movement, and I call it a movement, the Scholarship of Teaching and Learning, is interdisciplinary and invites all to come together and share, if you're trained in a certain way, as you are in STEM, and for those who may not be familiar, STEM stands for Science, Technology, Engineering, and Math, it's actually not that easy to move into the Scholarship of Teaching and Learning. So what I'm going to show you is actually the words of Susan and I. Within this group we were part of at CTLT, we approached a sociologist and said, you know, do you think there's something in this? And he said, definitely. And a PhD student who's just got her PhD, Carolyn Oliver, worked with us, and she recorded our discussions over the period of a year and obviously transcribed them. And so I'm going to tell you the story of two travelers, Susan Nesbitt, an engineer, and Neve Kelly, a scientist, trying to move from STEM to SOTL. Well, that was supposed to start with STEM to SOTL. So let me define what STEM is. In terms of thinking, and this is the way both Susan and I are trained, it emphasizes cause and effect thinking, deduction, and the quest for proof and certainty. But then you move into SOTL, and it values an inductive and abductive approach to inquiry, non-replicable observations, coming from science, and description and contextualized understanding. So the journey that we have we started to talk about, and others have joined us in talking about this, we've presented at a few conferences, and every time somebody comes up and says, can I join you? And we now actually have an international research group, including some other Irish people. And the journey is an iterative process of moving backwards and forwards between the familiar STEM approach and a new way of thinking and being. And to find this new way requires personal and emotional investment, immersion in a very different intellectual language. you've been to those talks, metacognition, hermeneutics or something like that, changing worldviews. And underlying all of this, it takes time. So why would you choose to do that when you're already established in your career path? Time. That was one of the big things that came out of our discussions. And in the words of one of us, time. Think about the time it takes you to learn a language, even if someone gives you the grammar, the words, the sentence construction. It's enculturation. It takes time, and that's the bit that to me has been missed in the literature. Susan and I were basically talking about, you know, perhaps informing faculty development as to what is needed for people making this journey. Another quote, enculturation isn't something you can do. It's a process that takes time. It's a process of internal dialogue, struggle, and it's an iterative process. We talked again about emotions, that there actually is, and again, something that's not talked about. It's not easy to move from a defined position that you've either moved to because it's your natural way of being, perhaps, moving into science, or that you have been enculturated in. It takes an emotional shift to move away from it. Because moving from being an expert in STEM to being a novice in this new subtle field engendered feelings of discomfort, anxiety, and huge vulnerability. You accept that you are ignorant. You must. And so there's a discomfort in that. And how you define yourself. If you're not an expert, what are you? The discomfort is coming because we can't box it. Let's face it, if you're trained in STEM, you really like boxing things. The joy that I'm having in beginning to try to understand my anxieties is that it's allowing me to have uncertainty, to accept that I can't wrap it all up. So I'm not looking to fit it into everything. I'm looking for a place where I can say I am transitioning and it is okay that I feel anxious transitioning. As a result of the work that Susan and I did with Carol and Oliver, we wrote and published an essay in IZOTL, the International Journal for the Scholarship of Teaching and Learning, and we called it Transitioning from STEM to SOTL. When we went to the international meeting, we then were approached by quite a few other people who came out of interest and said, I'm from the humanities, and SOTL is social studies. I'm also feeling foreign. So we've actually we're beginning to change our story to transitioning into SOTL, because it's not only for STEMmers, it seems, but it's actually foreign to a number of people. The joy that I, and what we're trying to bring out here is that once we work through that, once we accept it, partly by helping each other, that, you know, anxiety and sort of vulnerability, we were then able to move into this, accept our anxiety, and then able to experience it as a positive. So the joy that I'm experiencing is that I feel it's like looking at Google Earth and only looking at your own street for 30 years and all of a sudden toggling back out and thinking, wow, here's a new world, and I can see that area over here is where what I've been thinking about for 30 years, and this is how it fits into a much more messy worldview. So that brings us to the fact of language. Language is huge, like I just mentioned, when you go to these talks or you read these journals. And if you think about it, again, for somebody like me who moved countries, language is a part of your enculturation. I mean, you know, if you... Like if I say to you here, go out to the trunk of your car or the boot of your car, I'll immediately know from who recognizes it, who is also from, say, you know, England or Ireland. So language is huge. And so as I say, you know, I've sat through these talks and begun to glaze at epistemology, metacognition, constructivism, positivism, and then there's post-positivism. And even what was really fascinating to us when we began, the fun of dialoguing, of course, is that we were dissecting each other's thoughts. And we actually came one day to talk about the fact that attitudes and beliefs, there are English words we understand, but they're not words we understand in scholarship. Because if we walk down the corridors of the Faculty of Medicine or Engineering and saying, do you know what the attitudes and beliefs of your students are? Well, it's just not a conversation that our colleagues are used to having. So even words that we understand the meaning of in English, we don't understand the meaning of in terms of a scholarship. Language is seen as a barrier. It can be bridged, closing doors because the words have no meaning, or opening doors by acknowledging a shared understanding of the subject. And we talked about the fact that as we immersed ourselves more in this subtle literature and began to understand what people were talking about, then a word had meaning for us, and then that word could actually save you saying, you know, a multitude or a number of sentences. So it's, but it's definitely a sort of an obstacle to get in. Language conveys meaning. For communication to happen, the speaker and the listener must have already agreed upon a meaning. And that's huge, again, as I say, for those of us transitioning in, that the speaker is often unaware of who the audience is and as they use language, what it might mean, or whether even the audience can understand it. And finally, we came to this notion that worldviews was actually at the center of it, that we had, and actually when we continued our discussions beyond this piece of work, we actually got to the stage, Susan and I, of deconstructing science and engineering and realizing our worldviews were actually different. And we had this lovely analogy where we talked about a throughput, which is an engineering term. And so one day, after 2 hours of sort of not really understanding each other, I said to Susan, I think I have it. So I said, if there's this, let's just say there's some big happening at one end, and there's supposed to be water coming out the other, and it's going through all these pipes, and there's valves. And I said, if one of these, if it doesn't start to come out, and you find out it's this valve, what do you want to do? And she said, I want to get that valve working. I said, I don't. As a research scientist, I want to know why the valve didn't work. I want to know what makes the valve work. I just want to stick with that valve. I want to make my whole research career on that valve. And so suddenly we realized that even amongst us, we could deconstruct further into our disciplinary worldviews. And we realized that that was at the center of this transitioning. And if I still have time, which I think I have 5 minutes, I'll then go on to the second slide, which is where we deconstruct a worldviews. Hopefully that's it. Yeah. I think this is it. So we realize that being trained as STEMmers, if you like, as I said earlier, we you know, our way of being is cause and effect thinking, deduction, and this quest for proof and certainty. But subtle embraces a worldview that has a deep understanding of complexity and messiness versus a STEM worldview that really doesn't acknowledge complexity. And this was a huge breakthrough for us when we began. Susan was very familiar with complexity from her sustainability background, and I had been handed a book by somebody called How to Change the World. And it's a very interesting book, actually, and it's written by a guy from Waterloo University who is part of the complexity movement, if you like. So suddenly we had a way of talking together, and this was around complexity. And it really, for us, was our shift point into subtle, was to understand that complexity was part of it. One of the reasons that traditional scientists don't acknowledge this complexity is that as soon as they see it, they deduce it. They bring it to the simple, to the formula, to the measurable, to the hypothesis. But subtle values an inductive and abductive approach to inquiry. Remember, non-replicable observations, description, and contextualized understanding. And so that brought us to another point, which actually brought me home to another part of me, which was narrative, because I'm Irish, and the Irish way of being is narrative. I mean, if you look at Nobel Prizes, we have very few. In fact, I think you have to go back to the 1800s, and there's a mathematician or a physicist or something. But if you look in the 1900s, we have Yeats, Joyce, I think Beckett, and now in this century we had Heaney. I'm from a culture of narrative, so suddenly I began to realize that although a part of me had transitioned to STEM, there was a part of me that was missed. Because when I write papers in STEM, I don't use adjectives and I don't use adverbs. That's not the way you write about STEM. You want to get the points, so you use a verb and a noun. Suddenly I was in this world that invited me to use adjectives, adverbs, and I found myself coming home to a different part of myself, which was very exciting. Stories are a way of capturing complexity that you cannot capture in argument, in adversarial argument, or in a measure. Let's say I come in and I tell you a story about something that happened, and I leave it there. You don't say anything. But as you drive away, you begin to think about it for your case. And a little gem of something that was in my story speaks to something in yours. And as you think about it, it influences you. No argument. I'll leave it at that.
So you're ending with no argument.
No argument, Gary.
Thank you. Thanks for this opportunity, and thanks for this turnout. I'm going to stand over here so that you don't get a repeated use injury staring in one direction at all times. I'm in the School of Population and Public Health. We care about some of this stuff. The turnout today in this room, I would put it, says more than any single thing that I can say to you this afternoon. That's for sure. I don't know if you've had a chance to look around, and maybe you do and say, huh, what's going on here, you may ask. And it's great to see Simon place it in such a lovely, conceptually clear, and visually compelling context. And Neve's journey, which I've heard her talk about a few times, I think even though it did end with no argument, we'll have some. And it leads very nicely into what I've been asked to spend a few minutes talking about. So you've heard a bit about, conceptually, how we define the field, how we distinguish it from other endeavors related to teaching and learning. And you've heard a bit about what it's like to make a transition from one set of disciplines into a field. My job is to give you an example of SODL research. And that's what I'm going to do because, among other things, I'm immersed in a research project and have been for close to 3 years that would certainly fit within this world called the scholarship of teaching and learning. I'd like to say a little bit about where our questions come from. You'll notice a slide that Simon put up talking about process, and every one of those lines started with ask questions or asking questions. Where did those come from? I have facilitated workshops on research methods and so on related to SODL, and I've never had a problem asking any group, what questions do you have about teaching and learning? You will have them. You will have many of them. Even if you haven't paid a whole lot of attention to teaching and learning, you've been focusing on other things, you'll still have questions. So there are many, and I'll just say a little bit about where ours are coming from now. Then I'd like to show you, again, as Simon points out, it's true, it's going to be brief, but that's okay, briefly how we try to answer some of those questions. My background is cognitive psychology, unlike Neve, and Neve and I have had lots of conversations about this. Neve moving from the world of microbiology into SODL, me moving from cognitive psychology into research on teaching and learning. That step for me was much shorter than that step generally for Neve. We could have great conversations about teaching because we've been immersed in it all of our working lives. But our methods and our approaches and the language of the articles you get to read in the field are initially more accessible to me because there's a lot of cognitive psychology in learning theory and in the like. So it was a little easier step for me. Yet, the method that I want us to look at for a few minutes today is nowhere near what I was trained in. Nowhere near. And I've decided, hey, you either make this leap or you just take a whole bunch of learning outcome stuff and ignore it. That's your kind of alternative. And the last thing I'd like to try to do is to just give us a sense of what did it take for me to get doing this work? I guess it harkens back to the what we call 1S iSODL days, the Institute days, the questions that Lee Gass and I were asking when we established that Institute were simply, what's it going to take to mobilize that remarkable amount of curiosity that's out there in the university? What's it going to take? And now I'm kind of living that. And what did it take for me to get there? Again, I facilitated workshops at universities all over the place, and we've talked about what SODL can look like and really the promises of it. And then someone calmly comes up to me and says, thank you, Gary. Lovely stuff. Never happened here. And it's a bit discouraging because we had not answered the question, what would it take? Or they could say, it's all well and good for you, Gary. You directed a teaching and learning center. You established an institute. You were the president of an international society. It's easy for you. That's the world you've built around yourself. For everybody else who's been engaged in building other worlds, this is a much bigger leap. And that's another reason why when I talked to Neve and Susan about their leap, as we call it, it's really interesting. Okay, so the questions come from a fascination with what's called self-directed learning. I was fairly sure I had the term right when I first started, which is an advantage that I have. I speak the language a bit. Some of you will have questions. You don't have the language to articulate the question in ways that would allow you to search the literature. But self-directed learning, I knew the term well enough because in second year medicine, we established an option, and I called it the self-directed learning option. And that was no fluke. And it happened because a student came up to me in a course. Everyone in second year medicine was taking the course. We had these assignments laid out for them. It was essentially about population health. It was called Doctor, Patient, and Society, the grandest name a course ever had. And she said to me, the assignments that you've laid out for us for this year, I don't want to do them. And I'm quoting her. I was about to give her one of those lovely speeches we all keep in the back pocket about starting with phrases like, well, you know, in this life, there are times, and so on and so forth. And something, thank goodness, made me put that speech back in my pocket because I knew this student to be highly motivated. And I thought, why would she not want to do the assignments that about a half a dozen of us took a long time to craft? So I just said to her, what do you want to do? And she laid out this lovely plan for designing workshops and a curriculum related to sexual health. And she said, our curriculum is weak in this area. She was right. And I said, I think we can work something out. We can let you pursue your own goals. You tell us how you want to get there. You tell us what it will look like if you get there, which is assessment criteria. She said, great, I've got seven others. I said, seven other ideas? No, seven other students who we'd like to form a group. Way back many, many years ago, I used to hitchhike this way. One of us would be out on the street and the others would be behind a hedge. And I'm not advocating for that in this day and age. But that, and what happened to them hooked me. And all my questions came from that one big question. This isn't about learning about sexual health. It's about way more. And if I had to capture it in an image, all right then, it would be about this. Some of you will have seen this image. In fact, a lot of you. If you travel public transit, you will have seen this image. And there are many others like it. This woman, we'll call her Kate, has had a heart and lung transplant. She has had the organs involved painted onto her body, and a second-year medical student took photographs of her. It turns out that Kate and the second-year medical student were friends. Then, kind of like a first student a number of years ago, a few other students came up from behind, people came up from behind the hedge, and they said, I had a knee replacement. Would you be able to do that with me? I had a liver transplant. Would you be able to do that with me? And the student ended up taking a whole range of photographs of people with this painting. And this one, and maybe a few others, have appeared in public transit, and it is a health promotion exercise related to organ donation. Right? Now, during the photographing and the planning and all of this project, Kate died. Kate had cystic fibrosis. She'd had it, of course, all her life. When she was little, she couldn't say cystic fibrosis. She called it 65 roses. And you may know this story, and I'm changing names here, although she wouldn't mind, and neither would the student who I'm not naming, wouldn't mind if I went public with their names. I'm just not. The student and Kate knew that she was going to die. This was one of the huge motivators for the project. Well, we decided, you know, you can't just assume that this student's going to learn something about health promotion and photography. There's way more going on here. So we started to do in-depth interviews. I had done some of these in other research on people coping with serious illness. So I had some idea of the sort of funnel-shaped approach to semi-structured in-depth interview. And so we brought those methods to bear. We asked no questions about emotion until we interviewed this fellow. And we had no protocol. He just spontaneously started talking about the emotion, as you can imagine. And then we started listening for statements of emotion, even though we weren't asking for it. So we now had a whole series of questions around the relationship between emotion and learning, emotion and learning environments where there was a heightened degree of self-investment. And that's where our questions started coming from. This isn't just research. We're hooked. This isn't just curiosity. There's more involved. In fact, we have to be careful with that. We get very involved. How do we do this research? We use this. And now we're getting a long way away from anything I studied. I am a number cruncher at heart. A number of psychologists are, and I was very much a number cruncher. Likert scales make sense to me. 2x2 tables make the world go round. That's how I was trained, and I still believe it. Now you look at this. This is called the Geneva emotion wheel. Trust the Swiss. 20 emotions arranged in a circle. Ever-increasing diameter circles coming out. The word none, the word other in the middle. We are using this circle as follows. We give people, I would call them 1 inch, maybe 3 centimeter square post-it notes. We say, here's a stack of post-it notes. We'd like you to stick them on this wheel. You pick any emotions that you remember experiencing during your self-directed project work. The closer you get to the outside edge, the more intense the emotion is. So if there was real downright fear, you're out here. If there was a little bit of relief, you're in here. Not complicated. And on the post-it note, we'd like you to write a phrase or so to link that emotion to the element of your project that you think most closely elicited it. If you experience no emotions, fine, just put a note here. On the other hand, if there are other emotions that we haven't listed here, here's your space for them. Clutter this up as much as you want. We're going to leave the room now. There's two of us doing this at once. We're going to leave the room now and let you just play with this. When you're finished, come out into the hall and find us. We go back in, and there's the wheel covered with post-it notes. We have 2 different colors, 1 set of post-it notes that relate to project-related emotions, and 1 set of post-it notes related to life, or what we call personal emotions. We're using the term that leak into the project. We've got to change that term, because emotions don't leak into things. It's like you don't want them in there and the wall broke. That's not really how emotions work. And then we say, thank you for this. We just look at it for a moment and say, tell us the story of this wheel. That's it. And on they go. Well, the disappointment, the big, big disappointment came. See, our main objective in the project was to get eyeglasses for at least 500 people who need them in the downtown east side. Okay. And we haven't distributed a single pair of glasses, and we've been at this for 10 months. And that's particularly disappointing. Okay, carry on. Now you notice that the positive emotions are on this side and the negative emotions are on this side. And we've got a whole bunch of post-it notes for this person on this side. So we're waiting. Because that sounds like a complete failure and flop. But the person typically takes us around the wheel, ending where they want to end. Now, there's a long literature on the relationship between emotion and learning. Some of it in neuropsych, some of it in cognitive psychology. Things like negative emotions narrow attentional focus. So if you experience an emotion like fear because you're a bank teller and someone holds you up at gunpoint, and in comes the RCMP officer afterwards and says, what can you tell us about the person who held you up at gunpoint? Well, he had a gun. Okay, how tall was he? Did I tell you he had a gun? Yes, yeah. And then the RCMP will do something like this. They'll say, did you look at him straight? Did you look up or did you look down? I looked down at the gun. So emotion narrows attentional focus, perhaps for good reason. But positive emotion expands attentional focus and makes us different kinds of thinkers. So we then have follow-up probing questions about the potential relationship between those emotions on the wheel and your motivation, your ability to problem solve, your ability to think critically. The data we end up with is huge and messy. We take photographs of the wheel, and we have audio transcripts, which we have transcribed into print, and we do qualitative analysis on those. What did it take? What did it take for us to be able to do this research? Why can I do this research? I can do this research because Jennifer Kong waltzed into my working life. And if she hadn't, we wouldn't be doing this work. And Jennifer was she's an educator. She's an anatomist, working primarily in heart anatomy. She's very interested in teaching. She's great at it. She teaches here and at BCIT. And she had a bunch of questions. And we just ended up sitting probably at a workshop like this and starting to chat. And then a student who just finished her master's in MSc at School of Population and Public Health, Laura Dale, saw a presentation and came up and said, have you ever heard, well, it took her a while to find it, but you ever heard of something called the Geneva Emotion Wheel? I said, no. She said, yeah, it might be useful. The greatest understatement I've probably heard from a student. Without those two people, it doesn't get done. We don't even start. This is a little glint in my eye, and it never happens. Money, it's cheap research, but it's not zero. I'm lucky. We had some TLEF money, and part of the TLEF money could go to this work. And by virtue of being the associate director of the school, it's Kitty Corner from here, I get a small research stipend. I get $7,000 a year. And most of that goes to paying Laura and coffee vouchers for the people who do in-depth interviews and a bit of travel. Could we do the research without the money? Maybe, maybe, but it helps. But it helps. Time? No. I'm putting in 15% of the time that I should be putting into this. And we'd go slowly. And it would be, oh, what a delight it would be. But how many people in this room wouldn't like a little bit more time for some research? Or for anything? Okay, speaking of time, it's probably a good time for me to stop.
So thank you to all of our speakers. It was wonderful. I learned actually quite a bit. This was a really interesting project I didn't know anything about. And we'd like to spend the rest of the time on questions, discussion. And since we are recording, you have to use the mic. Otherwise, it doesn't pick up, I think, on the recording. So, and remember that if you do not want to be on the screen, if you could indicate that before we turn the camera over somehow, so that we don't do that for your question. So would anybody like to start us off? Should we move?
Sit down. Because as you set it up, I think we should at least sit down.
Thanks, Christine. Hi, I'm Sally Hermanson. I'm an associate dean in the Faculty of Arts, and I'm the one who got the email from the university of all of your email addresses to send you a notice about this event, and I really hope that was okay, and we will not abuse the email list. So thank you all so much for coming. For the panel, I just have a question. I mentor a lot of instructors in the Faculty of Arts, kind of up until the tenure phase. I'm very familiar with with that process. I'm just thinking about, again, this is a very practical question, but for the professor in teaching, which many of people here are probably thinking about as well, would you say for the files for SAC, it's a necessity to be involved in the scholarship of teaching and learning, to have a publication in one of the journals? What should we be aiming for now once we sort of have tenure and are moving forward, some of these types of projects or whatnot?
Yeah, go.
It's certainly not a requirement. That said, because there is a stream for scholarship in the research track, but whilst it's true that it's not a requirement, it's certainly an interest that a number of the people who I've spoken to in the instructor and senior instructor ranks. So it's not a requirement, but it's certainly not invalid as well.
So I've had the opportunity to review a few files going up for professor teaching for various reasons, and I haven't reviewed any that don't have some evidence of publication in what we would call SOTL. And it is not required. That's absolutely true. And I think we have to be careful that we don't create norms implicitly and put pressures on people that are unreasonable. But it's happening naturally. It might be because the two main criteria for professor teaching, many of you, maybe all of you will know, excellence in teaching and educational leadership. I think we're entering into an era in higher education where it's hard to pursue those two criteria without doing some kind of systematic investigation of something. It just happened. And maybe you can do it, but it's actually easier for many of us if we engage in that research. So one of the reasons why we're seeing it isn't because it's a wink, wink, nudge, nudge thing at UBC whereby, well, you'll never become professor of teaching unless you've got publications, even though you're not told to. That's not it. I think it's just a natural way of achieving, in some ways, that is getting toward those two main ones of excellence in teaching. Remember Simon's point about what scholarly teaching looks like, that lovely diagram with the arrows that built scholarly teaching and scholarship in teaching.
Maybe just to ask one more question for the group here, but
so years ago, before I knew what SALTO was, I published an article in my discipline's journal, which is cartography, mapping, a scientific journal, on how to teach a certain aspect of that and basically teaching about what I do in academia. Would that be considered SALTO? Would it be considered really the scholarship of teaching and learning if it was in a disciplinary journal as opposed to a, you know, journal of higher education or whatnot? Would that?
I would certainly say so, yeah, because, you know, my own disciplinary background is physics, and many of our discipline-based journals, you know, they have the Journal of Something Physics in the title, have sections or indeed entire articles devoted to scholarship and educational research within that disciplinary field.
Yeah, and that's part of the research that I'm currently doing. SOTL is I'm tracking the conversations that scientists are having when they publish in general, for instance, college teaching is a big one. There's another one called change. So I'm tracking the conversations they have when they're speaking outside their discipline and the conversations they have when they're speaking inside their discipline. And in my own case, I've published in both. So I've published in academic medicine, which is medical educators only will read. And then I've published in iZOTL, or IJZOTL, which is a journal. So, yeah, my understanding is they're both equally valid.
One follow-up comment on the requirement or otherwise of scholarly publications for the professor of teaching track. So at the moment, of course, it's increasing year on year. At the moment, there are 10 people ranked as professor of teaching. And although many of them do have publication records in scholarship, by no means all of them. Mm-hmm. And the group that we've actually constituted around the professors of teaching, so I'm one as well. We're a wonderfully kind of diverse and odd-shaped bunch, and I think that's entirely appropriate because in exactly the same way, there's no sort of defining mold for
a professor in research stream, I think over time that will become true in the professor of teaching stream as well.
I co-edit a journal called Teaching and Learning Inquiry, and we've reached the point, I think, in the discipline whereby a paper that describes a how-to, for example, how to run a workshop on writing dissertations in graduate school, that kind of thing, probably wouldn't get published in our journal. And what it would need is some measure of effectiveness, some measure of impact, something like that. And that, I know that adds to the story for sure. And there will be other journals perhaps that do publish the how-tos, that's fine. But know that if you think, and this is how so many questions come into being, boy, I think this just really worked. Other people need to know about this. Somebody's going to ask, what do you mean by worked? And by the way, there's a whole field of research in this area that doesn't have anything to do with whether something worked or not. There's all kinds of different kinds of questions you can ask. But we're pushing a little bit in that direction now as we publish.
With apologies for another SAC and tenure question, two in a row. One of the questions that I've been trying to sort of think through is, what is the relationship, and probably in terms of SAC more than in terms of the scholarship, but what is the relationship between publication of classroom materials and SOTL? So, for example, those of us in the arts and humanities write textbooks or editions that are used as textbooks or that sort of thing, and I'm wondering where that falls in this conversation.
I see that as an element of educational leadership. I remember, I think it was about 12 months ago, I was invited to speak to the instructor network on exactly what this kind of mysterious and slightly nebulous term of educational leadership encompassed. And I think the clearest definition I had was to encapsulate it as having impact beyond one's own classroom. And so production of teaching materials within your discipline, be that a textbook or, you know, other forms of materials, is one way to evidence a leadership role or a leadership contribution.
Hi, this is a question for Niamh. I think I found your presentation wonderful because as a specialist of medieval Japanese poetry, who's now transitioning, your words of language, complexity, narrative, enculturation, contextualization, all of these are words that I feel very comfortable with, right? And for me, it's the measuring side and all of these other de-abductive and yikes. And I do find that most of the information I'm getting at this sort of early stage is coming from the sciences side. And so coming from my side, this, what are some suggestions or encouragement for tackling that side? I mean, I feel happy with complexity, narrative, adjectives. Those mm-hmm. I like. Mm-hmm. Measuring terrifies me, right? And sort of this proving the measuring and that. So as the certificate program obviously would be one way, but are there other resources for those coming from medieval poetry?
Well, Gary may be a better one. I know Gary, one of your collaborators. I know, yeah. You know, when I go to the international conferences that, you know, it was so funny when that came up, somebody from the humanities said, hey, because when Susan and myself first started talking, we thought, you know, it's sort of like when you're a child and you think that there's yourself and other. So we thought it was just that, you know, it was us that were different, and then this whole SOTL world was, you know, humanities and social sciences and everything else. And then when we went, we found that the humanities also were. But Gary, I know when you were first, so I would find it difficult, of course, to answer because you're asking how do you transition into my part of the world that is a part of SOTL. And I don't know. I mean, I could invite Susan if she had any thoughts or anybody else. But I know, Gary, you work with somebody in, isn't your co-editor in the journal?
Some
isn't
of my
she?
Best friends are in the humanities.
I thought that was part of behind. I remember when it you is. First talked about yeah. establishing the journal.
Absolutely. So the other co-editor of Teaching and Learning Inquiry is a woman named Nancy Chick, and she's from Vanderbilt, and she may have written some of the quotes that we've seen here today. And Nancy's an English scholar. When the International Society for the Scholarship of Teaching and Learning went looking for editors, Nancy submitted a proposal. She said, the vision that I have is that it invites everyone in. And Nancy, her last name's just spelt as you might think, C-H-I-C-K, Google her, please, if you're interested in this, because she's written about how the humanities can be included in ways that I simply couldn't match. So that's one. We have published poetry in TLI, as we call it, and that would have been a submission that Nancy was better positioned to send out for review and so on. So that world needs to open up. The other piece, and this is, I think, it's published in a medical education journal, so you might say, huh, can I read it? And you certainly could. It's called, and again, this is just very Googleable, it's called It's Not Rocket Science. That's the title. Oh, you've seen this. Yeah. So you've seen Glenn Regeer's article. Because that's a lovely way of thinking about different purposes for scholarship beyond the does it work? And you know, with all due respect to physics education research, which has been a real leader in SOTL, for sure. With all due respect, to that, there's a lot of does it work research in physics and engineering, and why not? You know, hearkening to the comments that Neve made. But so it's quite heartening to read Glenn's piece on, you know what? Shedding light on complexity is a valuable contribution, people. That's just one of the things, right? So I'm glad you've seen it.
Thank you all three so much for that lovely discussion and talk. I have a question that I think people might find of interest, and that is, you know, we've talked about dissemination in terms of publications. Do you have any comments, any of you, about where else people might disseminate their understanding, their growing understanding of teaching and learning? I mean, and Simon, I know you may have thoughts on that as well.
This would be Simon Albin.
Yeah, Simon Albin, I know you may have thoughts.
I'm sorry, I'm still deep in thought of these three presentations. I guess what I could add to that, Susan, my name is Simon Albin, pharmacy, is conferences. So I'm sure in your disciplines there's opportunities to present at conferences. And the people in our faculty that are just starting to get into this, what I suggest to them to do is to start simply. Find a comfortable place where you can present your work, perhaps in a poster, maybe a small podium presentation, and just work up from there. So, but it's about going out and engaging in those kind of environments as a good place to start.
Maybe make one other comment. Without wanting to sort of divert the conversation too much off topic, more and more, I find I'm turning to sort of social media sources and blogs and if you like, grey literature or informal communications. And two examples of this. So whenever I go to conferences, I tend to share my slides using a service called SlideShare. And I think it was last year I was giving a presentation at STLHE, and I was particularly organized. I finished the slides the night before, which is pretty organized. And so I uploaded them to SlideShare. And then I think the talk was sort of 11 o'clock the next morning. And there were about 40 or 50 people in the room. It was a lively session. And I happened to show someone afterwards who was saying, can I get a copy of the slides? I said, yeah, they're here. I had 10 times as many views online as the number of people who'd actually sat in the room to hear the talk. And a second example of the kind of reach that online communication and collaboration will give you access to. And I was reminded of it by one of my colleagues was asking me just before we started if I would go and give a talk at their departmental seminar about an experience I had last year. I teach on this large physics course, but I co-teach it with somebody else, so we share the teaching, and it's not just the case of, well, you do the first 8 weeks, and then I'll come in and fill in, and you have a holiday, but we're genuinely there in the classroom sessions together, and we build them collaboratively. And one idea we had out of that, I got a lot of time to observe her class, and likewise for her, and we had a conversation around an issue that might resonate with many of you, and that is students using digital devices during class time for things other than on-topic activities. Right? And the story that, I apologize if some of you have heard me say this, the sort of the time I knew we had to act was when I witnessed one of the students in the course buying socks online in the middle of a lecture. Right? Now, my co-teacher said, well, it could have been worse. They might have chosen to buy those socks at home and not come to the lecture, which is a very positive way of looking at it. The discussion that we had was, well, why don't we let the students decide what the acceptable use policy is for technology in the classroom? So we used the sort of slow time at the start of the course, the first few sessions, where we said to the students, you're in charge, you go and decide what you think is acceptable. We'll debate it if there's any contention, and then we'll agree it, and it's your policy, and you can stick to it and enforce it. And so we wrote a sort of 700-word blog post on this together to a site called Pedagogy Unbound, which is a new site that's basically gathering these little nuggets of useful information. And I think about a week ago, we published it, I think October or so. A week ago, it got retweeted and then retweeted. And I was getting all these emails from people. And, you know, just from, we probably wouldn't have published that in a journal article. It wasn't substantive enough for a conference presentation. Yet I think we found an outlet that reached a wider group of people. So I guess the main conclusion is diversity, really, and there's many more outlets simply than just peer-reviewed publications and yearly international conferences.
So can I come back to your question now that I've had time to think? I think one of the answers, because I'm thinking about the piece of work I presented with Susan, and we couldn't have gone further if we hadn't reached out to a social scientist and said, can you help us? And so the other person is Carolyn Oliver. And so I think to come back to yours, and so she brought the qualitative methodology and understanding to us. So if you're having trouble navigating a quantitative approach in SOTL, I would highly recommend looking for a collaborator. And in my faculty is faculty of medicine, way back when I started doing medical education, one of the leaders there said to me, Niamh, always look for collaborators because it'll just, you know, it'll be so much more fun. There's the brain power and everything. So I think I just, you know, I would say maybe look for a collaborator who, you know, has that STEM mindset.
A tame scientist?
Can I ask a follow-up question to what you were just saying, Simon? Because I have a blog, and I put a lot of my teaching stuff on my blog, and I also, you know, read lots of other people's blogs and do a lot of Twittering of people's blogs, etc. Now, can I somehow put that into my dossier? Like, I've written a lot of blog posts, but I don't know how many people have read them. I've gotten 2 comments, but... like, is that going to be evidence somehow of impact beyond my classroom?
I think you can put it in if you can evidence impact. Okay. Right? Because you don't, you know, what the publication or the conference, well, there's prestige attached to the type of conference or the impact factor of the journal or the number of citations or something like that. I don't know how you evidence the impact from that.
Comments, maybe if you get a lot of comments on something, maybe if you get some emails or invitations from it, something like that. Okay, I'm just curious. Thank you.
Just a thought that the evidence from that, if you know who's looked at it, and you're looking to put something in your dossier for promotion, is contact them, to ask them how they used it, because maybe they did.
Oh, yeah.
And actually... since I have the mic, question for Niamh. I was
I'm wondering if you've connected your process and what you went through to what students go through, your own students. You know, have you used your own learning, in a sense, to understand other people's learning?
It's interesting you say that, because the first, so I go to the annual ISOTL conference, and then Susan and I presented it the first time with Carolyn. And then, like I say, we had quite a lot of people come up to us. And so we decided, and as we were around the conference for the next 3 days, lots of people approached us and told us that they found it very meaningful, and we got emails afterwards. So the next year we went back, but we had to do something different. And I actually tied it on the last day of that conference. I went to this talk about threshold concepts, which I'm sure a lot of you have heard. And apparently that's a big thing in, like, in any discipline when you're teaching. It's sort of, there are these concepts that until the students get those under their belt, they're not really going to move on. Well, I hadn't heard of it. And so I sat there and I thought, wow. So there, and they were talking about it. They had different disciplinary. They had, you know, humanities. They had a scientist, whatever. And they were all talking about this threshold concepts. And I thought, well, they were talking about it in terms of being teachers of their students. And I thought, well, that's what it's like for somebody trying to move into SOTL. So in that sense, yeah, there is. I mean, I think it's very similar that for people like me moving into this new scholarship, I think it's the same sort of thing. Like, and I suspect I could layer it over where I'd ask students, like those hit points, like emotion, time, worldviews, complexity, language. So I do think that there's a very similar approach to us learning. And I think that's part of the humbling for me, to be honest, is that I suddenly realized, I mean, I haven't thought about it in this term maybe until you asked the question, but when I say part of the anxiety was going from an expert to a novice, I think part of it may also be going from the teacher to the learner. Yes. And although we may sort of subconsciously give voice to that, we don't consciously. We still probably see ourselves as, the expert, the deliverer of the teacher. But in this whole process, so yeah, it's an interesting way to think about it.
I've got a question for the panel around ethics and ethics approval. And could you speak a little bit about the sort of ethics approval process that you may or may not have gone through? We've had quite a bit of discussion in our faculty about that, and the idea of putting a BREB proposal together for the work that faculty would like to do is representing quite a barrier. So how have you dealt with that?
Okay, I'll do the BREB one. Behavioral Research Ethics Board, for those of you who haven't heard that acronym, and there will be very few SOTL projects that don't require BREB approval. There is a subcategory that may not require BREB approval if it looks very much like program evaluation and program improvement. And if that's the case, whether you publish it or not, according to documents that we've had from University Council here, you don't need BREB approval. That said, you should never take that for granted, and you need to ask. There are journals that won't publish your work unless you've got BREB approval, even if your own university doesn't think you need it. So think ahead. So a lot of us go through BREB, and I've got the BREB bruises. At the same time, I need to say emphatically that over the last 7 or 8 years, BREB has really climbed the learning curve on this. In the early going, the idea that an instructor would conduct research involving his or her own students was unthinkable. It seemed too messy, couldn't be done. Then a faculty member from education wrote an interesting piece, I think she was on BREB at the time, on participatory action research and the idea that BREB was actually ignoring a very large and growing methodology. So that, whoops! And that was helpful. So we've taken leaps in that regard. And now filling out a BREB application is, in fact, I'm going to say beneficial for research. We typically go to our BREB application and begin filling it out before we have every detail figured out, like in those interviews, what the prompt questions after filling out the wheel are actually going to be, that kind of thing. because every BREB prompt that you have to fill out forces you to think those details through. It's really nice. And as I say, BREB is getting much better at understanding the viability of doing this kind of research. The committee meets, I think, about every 3 weeks. So is it two now? Oh, that's right. They pumped it up, I think, of this at the last. Anyway, this can be time-consuming. Also, and just kind of be patient and zen-like about that and stay with it. There are other faculties and groups also that have separate committees that have control over access to students being involved in educational research. Medicine has one. And without that approval, you can't go further. Medicine has it because our students get asked to take part in a lot of educational research now, which is delightful, except they have a few other things to do. And you'll see these cropping up too. So know what your hurdles are in that regard. And yeah, approach it quite positively. There's no question that the process now for us hones our thinking. No question.
So, and if I can add to that for medicine, because when we were doing our distributed curriculum, going back 10 years now, and we were planning it, because you said a number of your faculty, our evaluation unit, I think it was Chris Levette, did it, did something quite smart, because most of us were involved in that, also had some questions we wanted to ask around, you know, planning this new distributed curriculum. So she wrote a very broad-based BREB application, because I know when I came to ask a question and, got in touch with somebody, she looked it up and said, yeah, your question is covered in this. So if there's a lot of faculty and if there's certainly a big change happening in your curriculum, it's worth finding who is the central person who can, and I mean, it wasn't cheating in any way. It's just that it was written in such a nice broad way that it said, we will be asking about X, Y, and Z. And then, you know, that really covered quite a multitude. So I think it can be worth it if there's a major change going on in your faculty.
This is kind of related. So we all have our questions, but then the how-to becomes the question, really, and where can I find resources? And so, you know, how to do a BREB and so on, that would be one resource, but also how to find possibly grant money. What are good grants to apply for discipline-based research and other, or programmatic research and so on? So my question then is there one, let's say, information resource that lists possibly all the questions I could have from start to finish and guides me through it?
I think the breadth thing, it is a problem because I think it's so contextualized that trying to kind of assemble answers to that across a wide range of disciplines with deep enough resolution, I think that would be a major undertaking.
Okay, but more concrete, you know, finding, let's say, just deadlines for important grants that we all have, like, for instance, TLEF was listed on our departmental thing.
Certainly internally, yeah. I mean,
learn and stuff like that.
Yeah, internally, certainly. Externally, that I think requires more detailed knowledge of the discipline or the funding council policies or things like that. But internally, certainly.
But also knowing where to search and how it branches out then would be helpful, I think.
Is there somewhere on the CTLT site that one would start?
Not at the moment. We're actually engaged in the process of looking at our website with redesigning it because, like many websites, it's kind of like an untended garden. It's growing and developed offshoots, and though it houses a huge amount of information, it's not always easy to find the information in a number of clicks that you could count on several hands. So do you want to say something?
Just to add this small plug that we're actually also in the process of mapping the questions that people have in order to find better support. So Brevin, Paddy, always has the main question.
Hi, I'm Tara Ivanochko from Earth, Ocean, and Atmospheric Sciences. And I don't know if this is maybe just one other element. We have worked with now, they're called the Center for Community Engaged Learning, in a 400-level project-based class where we have students going out into the field. And this year we had to have all of our students in all of the groups, 10 different groups, do BREB for different components of what they were doing. And through that process we built a template for them or a guide for them in how they might consider this and what was involved in the different questions. And so that resource is now there with community engaged learning. And they, I don't know if they have it for classes that are doing other things in humanities or other areas, but they might have, through some of their caseworkers, the ability to pull some of these things together. Mm-hmm. Again, it was focused on student projects, but at least there's something to start with, maybe, in areas like that.
So just to follow up on that, in the Faculty of Arts, we have worked with REB people to totally facilitate community-based research projects for our students. And maybe the instructor network that kind of brought you this event, we have an advocacy sort of section to our mandate, and maybe we can work on this with Simon and CTLT to put together some guidelines for BREB so that it will facilitate the scholarship of teaching applications that go in, similar to what we've done with the community-based learning. And the other thing I just wanted to say is part of our network. Did you say this at the beginning? I was a few minutes late.
I just said a little bit earlier.
Okay, because we are going to host a showcase. Did you tell them about that? We are going to host a showcase. We have a date that we will send you in April. So maybe we can use that date to have some more examples of scholarship of teaching and learning and bring some of these as well to kind of build on today's event.
I want to come back to the point briefly about dissemination. So this requires a little mental bookmarking, if you can remember. Susan has brought it up. And Simon gave some very good advice that I want to just underscore and perhaps give not a different take, but a little addition to. That was, when it comes to dissemination, diversify. Now think of the many, many different ways that you can. So my take on it is as follows. When Lee Gass and I were writing the proposal for the creation of the Institute for the Scholarship of Teaching and Learning, we knew we were going to get the following question. Why does this university need another institute? And the more gripping question, why should the university put any money toward an institute? We don't tend to do that. And the answer that we gave, which worked, related to dissemination, and we said dissemination in SOTL is different in some ways from other kinds of dissemination. And the model that we used featured a series of concentric circles. So we're used to disseminating broadly, and that's the publications, that's the national and international conferences and the like, and that's fantastic. In fact, on one career path, that's how you become a full professor. You get international, you get big. And a lot of our institutes here that are famous and should be are famous because they just get big right away, and they go to the outer circles. We claimed that we were going to disseminate at every possible level of those circles, right down to the hallway, which I noted was on, I think, one of your slides, the hallway conversation, departmental retreats, department meetings, whatever the faculty equivalent is of the Science Supper series, and out it goes. And I really urge you, when you think about diversity, to think about those concentric circles. You don't necessarily, I think it's a great idea, start with something you can manage that isn't necessarily within your department or your unit. It might actually be to an international conference where you present a poster. And it might be that speaking to your own colleagues about SOTL is actually some of the more challenging work you do. And you might not start there, but think of them all. Because when you put your case together for educational leadership and you want to sort of mobilize your scholarly work to make that case, if you have a sense of that range of the dissemination, that's a really powerful case. And it's a case, I'm sounding smug here, that some other disciplinary research can't make. There, I said it.